Too many days in the darkness, without a glimpse of the light. With every star, we are born again.
Let life flow from the people you know with ultra fast charging from BP Pulse, making your move to EV easy.
There we go. I can stand up now. I'm not used to this. I'm used to doing webinars, aren't I? Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this afternoon's session, which is Charging Infrastructure Cradle to Grave. I'm delighted to have on the stage with me today Lizzie Culwick, who's going to talk about, you're from the OZEV, Office of Zero Emissions, that will be talking about the legislation side of things and sort of the offer. And then Dr. Euan McTurk, that I've had the pleasure of being on a stage with before, he'll be talking through. What are you talking through?
I'm talking about the tech behind fleet EV charging.
Tech. And then we have Alex Potts, the sponsor from BP Pulse.
Thank you, Donna.
So I will hand straight over to Lizzie, who's going to do a far better job at starting this than I've just kicked off with. Lizzie, over to you.
Thanks, Lorna. I don't know about that. I'm really pleased to be here today to discuss how fleets can transition to zero-emission vehicles. Government recognises the really crucial role that fleets can play in the UK's decarbonisation of transport, with over half of new cars being bought by fleets. I'm Deputy Head of the Office for Zero-Emission Vehicles, and OZEV for short. And for those who don't know, OZEV is a joint unit which sits across two government departments, the Department for Business, Energy, Industrial Strategy, and the Department for Transport. OZEV is specifically set up like this, so we have oversight of all the policies that affect the rollout of zero-emission vehicles across the country, and has been particularly helpful in the context of recent energy price rises. So what is OZEV trying to achieve? And what industry support is available? So transport alone is responsible for around a quarter of the UK's greenhouse gas emissions. In fact, if we eliminated road transport tomorrow, we would have overnight reduced transport's contribution to greenhouse gas emissions by around 90%. That's a challenge and an opportunity for us. The government's 10-point plan for reaching net zero greenhouse gas emissions by 2050 confirmed that the UK will phase out the sale of new petrol and diesel cars and vans by 2030. From 2035, all new cars and vans must be zero emission at the tailpipe. This clear long-term ambition, combined with existing government support for industry, will help cement the UK's leading position in the design, manufacture, and use of zero emission road vehicles. The timeline on this slide highlights the steps we are taking to achieve those targets, including the zero emission vehicle mandate and funding for EV charging infrastructure. Many of those I'm going to cover in more detail today. I'm going to start with incentives that are around for zero emission vehicles. So to date, government has provided 1.6 billion of grants to support the purchase of zero emission vehicles. That's contributed to the rapid rise in the number of zero emission vehicles on the roads over the last year, 8 years, which you can see on this slide. Last week, it was announced that a total of 1 million plug-in vehicles have been registered in the UK, which is a great milestone to have reached. A variety of government support remains for fleet owners wishing to transition to zero-emission vehicles. This includes the plug-in vehicle grant, which remains open for taxis, motorbikes, vans and trucks, and wheelchair-accessible vehicles, despite the closure of the plug-in car grant over the summer. All zero-emission vehicles remain exempt from vehicle excise duty, and van drivers pay a nil rate of tax on the van benefit charge. There are also favourable benefit-in-kind tax rates available. However, the transition to zero emission road transport depends on a convenient and consumer-friendly charging infrastructure. As the sale of plug-in vehicles continues to rise, we've published a landmark strategy setting out the government's plans to accelerate the rollout of a world-class charging network. We published the EV charging infrastructure strategy in March this year, which sets out the vision and commitments to make EV charging more convenient than refueling at a petrol station. The UK network of charge points is already growing, and on average, around 600 new chargers are being added to the road network each month. And to date, government and industry have supported the installation of 33,600 publicly available charging devices, including 6,200 rapid devices. We know more are required and expect at least 10 times more public charge points to be installed across the UK by the end of the decade, bringing the number to around 300,000 by 2030. To support this, 1.6 billion of government funding will be used to facilitate the rollout of charging infrastructure. We know that the majority of EV drivers currently charge at home, but we must ensure that public charge points are in place to support those without off-street parking and to enable the kind of long-distance journeys that some fleets make. This 1.6 billion of funding will be targeted to support infrastructure for those drivers. We have two main EV infrastructure schemes, so the Rapid Charging Fund and the Local EV Infrastructure Fund, known as LEVI for short. Charge anxiety has been identified as the primary concern for prospective EV drivers. So a visible and functional charging network along the UK strategic roads is vital for people making longer journeys and for mass EV adoption. The Rapid Charging Fund is a 950 million investment to future-proof the electricity capacity at motorway and major A road service areas to prepare the network for 100% zero emission car and van fleets. The fund is designed to accelerate industry's own investments in transport decarbonisation, delivering charge points where they are commercially viable. Under a Rapid Charging Fund, by 2023, next year, we aim to have at least 6 ultra-rapid charge points at motorway service areas in England, with some larger sites having many more. And by 2035, we expect about 6,000 ultra-rapid charge points across all England's motorways and major A-roads. However, government also recognise the huge importance of local on-street charging solutions. To ensure the transition to electric vehicles takes place in every part of the country, the government has pledged at least 500 million to support local charge point provision. This will support local authorities to work with residents, businesses, fleets, and industry to identify and respond to the local EV charging needs. In August, the 10 million LEVI pilot scheme was launched to deliver 1,000 on-street charge points across 9 local authorities, acting as a springboard for the then future full 500 million LEVI fund. The EV infrastructure strategy I mentioned earlier highlighted a number of areas where government intends to regulate to ensure charge points are reliable and easy to use. There are 3 kind of main things that we're targeting regulation at. Mandating open data, so consumers can easily find a charge point that matches their needs. For van users, that might involve identifying charge points with parking bays with longer or wider parking bays. Mandating 99% reliability across the rapid charging network, so people are confident that they will be able to charge when they get to a charge point. And introducing simplified payment methods, so they are transparent and easy to use. We'll continue to review and listen to feedback from industry on the UK's charging infrastructure and consider whether broader regulations than those are required. I hope that's given you a useful insight into the current government's ambitions and investments in the UK's transition to zero emission vehicles, and I look forward to our discussion shortly.
Thank you, Lizzie.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. So we'll now have a little discussion about the tech in electric vehicle charging for fleets. So little bit, first of all, about me, who's talking to you today. I'm Dr. Euan McTurk. I'm a consultant battery electrochemist who's been working on, as well as driving electric vehicles, since 2009. I started off in the lab working on new chemistries for EVs and then pivoted towards what's commercially available, sticking extra electrodes and probes in them, the likes of the cells out of a Tesla Model S, to see just how hard you really can push them, opening up that black box system, seeing how they degrade, how we can stop them degrading. I then moved on to building up a battery test facility, 200 kilowatt battery test facility from scratch, and then founded my own consultancy where I'm helping academia, industry, business and government with everything to do, not just with the battery electrochemistry, but electric vehicles, charging infrastructure and energy storage too. I've also got my humble little YouTube channel, Plug Life Television, that explains a lot of this and busts some myths along the way. But as for today, what should I look for in fleet charging infrastructure? If you are new to this, we'll kind of go back to the basics of how to charge an EV and the different ways and means about it. But my top tip for fleet charging infrastructure is that it should be first and foremost reliable. You want to make sure that you always weigh quality above cost in any tenders that you do. Otherwise, you'll end up ripping it out and having to spend more money to replace it. You want to make sure there's excellent customer support. Check the lead times that are agreed on servicing of your infrastructure. You want to make sure that you've got technicians and parts to hand locally within the UK rather than waiting on components being shipped halfway around the world. And you also get bonus points for hardware that can diagnose faults before they actually occur to the extent that the hardware falls over completely. And also, you want to make sure that it's easy to manage as well. So that's where the back office comes in, the server that administers your charging sessions, starting, stopping, and in the case of a public charging network, billing. So you want to make sure you've got easy access to that data as a fleet manager. You want to make sure that you can potentially schedule charging sessions. If you have off-peak electricity that works out cheaper, you'd want to be at a stage where you can just plug in that vehicle and then it doesn't start charging immediately. It deliberately gets delayed until your off-peak tariff kicks in. You also want to be able to restrict access on depot charging infrastructure so that you don't get someone coming in off the street and then pinching free electrons off you. And you want to make sure that it's future-proof as well. So we're looking today at back offices communicating via OCPP 1.6, Open Charge Point Protocol. That's what most people are using, but 2.0 is out there as well. It's a very different language, but that's how the back office, the server, if you wish, and the charge point or the charging infrastructure communicate with each other. You want to make sure it's at least one of them and that your back office and your hardware are both in agreement with that. They're speaking the same language. And you also, if you're expanding a fleet with a limited grid supply, you want to look into dynamic load management, which I'll explain about with some helpful infographics later on. Always do your due diligence as well. Obviously, salespeople are in sales for a reason. Ask other owners of that infrastructure, ask other fleet managers, what did you do, what worked for you, what didn't? Is this particular brand reliable? And also, you know, local authorities are a good example of people who own or have access to a lot of charging infrastructure, public as well as their own fleet, so worth getting in touch with them. And real-world feedback from actual EV drivers, and the likes of EVA England, Electric Vehicle Association of England, or EVA Scotland as well. They'll be able to provide some useful real-world feedback from loads of different makes and models of not just car, but vans, etc. So how should I provide charging infrastructure for my fleet? Well, there's two ways that you can charge an electric car, and the first is AC. So the format that's won the format war, if anyone's not used to EVs yet, is Type 2. That's the socket that's on virtually every EV today. And it's what you'll find on the socket of a charge point. So a charge point, AC charge point, you have your grid connection to the charge point that then provides AC electricity to the car, which then goes into its onboard charger, which converts that to DC, which is what's needed to charge the battery. So AC charging is basically limited to the maximum power of the car's onboard charger or the maximum power supplied by the charge point, the lesser of the two. That's ideal for charging of pool cars overnight, for example, or opportunity charging during the day. It's typically 7 kilowatts if you're on a single phase power supply. You can actually go up to, I've said 22 there, that's the most common kind of limit. You can actually go up to 43, but there's very few vehicles that take 43 kilowatt AC. It's typically between 7 and 11 kilowatts, whether it's single or three phase. And it's also fairly cheap to buy and install. There's some interesting AC options out there. If you've got limited space in your depot, for example, then Connected Kerb has a very discreet bollard that's designed for on-street installations. It's also loaded with tech like 5G connectivity. It's got a heritage-friendly design. It's quite discreet. And then Zaptec is another one which I quite highly recommend. It's robustly built. It's IP67 rated with the front cover off. So it was designed in Norway, which knows a thing or two about extreme weather. I have one of them on my driveway, and I definitely recommend it. They have designs that are more catered towards fleets as well. And both of these actually offer dynamic load management. So what is dynamic load management? So if we take an example here where you've got 6-7 kilowatt charge points, and you don't have dynamic load management, but you've got a 30 kilowatt power supply that actually comes into your site, then say you've got 4 of your vehicles connect and start charging. That's fine. You know, you're 28 kilowatts, you're still below 30, that's perfectly fine. But if 2 more come along and plug in, then you're going to exceed the grid supply to your site, you're going to trip it. That's no use to you. But if you have dynamic load management, then what happens is the master unit on it realizes, hang on a minute, I'm about to go above my maximum power supply. And the master unit then goes, okay, how can I juggle electrons accordingly within my limits? And in this case, it's downrated everyone to 5 kilowatts, so you stay within your means without having to pay for a grid upgrade. So that's what dynamic load management is. That's why it's handy. It can save you money on grid upgrade costs later on. And as I say, it's future-proof as well, because if you are perfectly fine with the kind of slower charging overnight, and you're not getting to the stage where the combined charging power is so low that the car isn't ready by the morning, then you can just add more charge points. You can daisy chain them on. Quite a lot of designs that support dynamic load management will allow kind of daisy chaining up to a point where eventually, as your fleet grows, you will need to upgrade the grid supply. But that buys you a lot of time. It saves you a lot of money. But what if your electric vehicles are very large? Say you've got bin lorries, say you've got heavy-duty vehicles. Maybe they're in constant use. Maybe it's a smaller vehicle like a taxi, but it's just constantly on the go. Then how can you charge them in minutes rather than hours? So DC charging is where you're basically bypassing the onboard charger. CCS has won the format war. CHAdeMO was found on the likes of the Nissan Leaf, if you're new to EVs. So what happens here is the actual hardware itself that you plug into the car is the charger. So AC electricity is fed to the rapid charger, converts it to DC, which is then fed into the car, bypassing the onboard charger, and that means that you can get considerably higher power charging. So that is perfect, as I say, for quick top-ups or for overnight charging of very big vehicles with very big batteries where 7 kilowatts on AC just wouldn't cut it. So, for example, bin lorries. Typically, you're looking at 25 kilowatt minimum. That's less encountered. You're typically sort of 40, 50 kilowatts above. And you can actually go above 350 kilowatts now. There's some very high power charging options on the market. They are more expensive to buy and install and maintain. There's more going on with them, but the grid connections can be pricey as a result. That's something to bear in mind. However, if you need them, you need them. So there's some interesting DC options as well. There's the Kempower T-Series portable charger. So if you have a three-phase red commando socket, I'll show you a photo of one later on. It's very common in commercial and industrial premises. You can plug a rapid charger into that without needing concrete foundations, without needing a new grid connection. It's literally a plug-and-play rapid charger, and that saves you, again, a lot of time and a considerable amount of money. And then there's the S-Series from Kempower, which does dynamic load management, and I'll show you how it does that later on. So if you're dipping your toes into DC, I mentioned the plug-and-play solution. That means you're not having to apply for a new grid connection. You're not having to apply, you're not having to reach out to civil engineers to put in concrete foundations, etc. So if you've got a red commando socket, you can get a portable rapid charger like the T-Series, and that gives you an instant plug-and-play charging option. A lot of Welsh local authorities use them with their electric refuse collection vehicles. That can be literally wheeled into place. It's easier to wheel the charger to these big, heavy vehicles than it is to maneuver these big, heavy vehicles to the charger. But you can also get a steel crash protection structure that can be either high-abbed or forklifted into place, so it's quite neat. As I say, that's up to 40 kilowatts on CCS. You can also split 20-20, you can charge 2 cars at once. And it's comparatively low cost for the reasons I've just mentioned. And also, if you're moving premises, you can take it with you without having to dig things up. So it's really easy to do. And as I mentioned, Welsh local authorities seem to love them in particular. And that happens to be compliant with OCPP 2.0, so the kind of fancier back office, if you wish. It has its 4G SIM, it has its RFID reader. It's a bona fide, fully-fledged public rapid charger almost that you can just plug in. So there's loads of connectivity, loads of management options. But what about dynamic load management on DC? So I'd mentioned that you can do it on DC as well. Typically with rapid chargers, if you've got a fairly limited grid supply and you're having to do what you can with that without paying for an upgrade, then you've got a couple of options. You've either got standalone chargers, which cannot share power between them, or you've got chargers which do share power between them, typically only in pairs, but then they immediately split that power 50-50, regardless of which car needs what power, as soon as two cars plug in. So let's have a look at this. So there's underutilization of the supply, and there's bigger, more expensive grid connections if you need to add more chargers to get higher power, etc. So if we have a BMW i3, for example, that can charge at 100 kilowatts. If it tries to use one of those two 50 kilowatt rapid chargers, it'll only ever get 50, despite the fact the other one's sitting unused. You could, there's 100 kilowatts of power there, but it can't take advantage of it. Similarly, if you've got another ID3, it wants 100 kilowatts, but it's only going to get 62.5 here, despite the fact that the other car, the MX30 there, the Mazda, can only charge at 37 kilowatts. So it's got spare power on that side, but it can't be utilized. So with the S-Series that I mentioned before, you have, well, it's the S-Series is what you actually plug into the car, but then you have the C-Series, which is the power cabinet, like so. And that has lots of power modules in it, 25 kilowatt power modules. And those can be fed to an S-Series dispenser, CCS or CHAdeMO, in any order, and it will swap those power modules on the fly as vehicles come and go, as they get fuller and the charging power tapers off and other vehicles are waiting for more. So again, we look at this example here. If you've maxed out your available grid supply with the amount of power modules that you can put into the C-Series cabinet or cabinets that you have, then those modules are allocated to EVs in 25 kilowatt segments, like so. So it's pretty much exactly what everyone's after, rather than an arbitrary, you'll get what you're given. And that means that your faster charging EVs get more modules, and the slower charging EVs get less. And as I mentioned before, if you have a vehicle that's starting to get quite full and its charging power tapers off, then what you'll find is, in the case of this EV that's now a faster charging one waiting for more modules, that Ioniq 5 there is now starting to get full, so we can donate one of its power modules to the ID3, which has just bumped up its charging speed. And this just happens continuously. It's all automated within the system. So you can do things like that with dynamic load management on DC, as well as the version I explained on AC. And there's also the ChargEye software with this, which, as I mentioned previously, there are some brands of hardware and some back offices that allow you to schedule charging. So if you have a fleet depot of electric buses, electric lorries, etc., and you have, say, a five-hour off-peak charging window that's really cheap in comparison to the rest of your electricity, then you can deliberately delay the start of the charging of all these vehicles connected to the system by going into ChargEye and saying, these are my cheap hours, this is my maximum grid supply, I need my vehicles charged by this time in the morning, you figure it out, and ChargEye does that. And if you're adding more vehicles to your fleet, you can add more dispensers, up to the point that the allocation of power modules is too slow, at which case you would obviously need a grid upgrade eventually. But again, that basically buys you a lot of time, and it saves you a lot of money in the interim. And if you've gained additional grid capacity, then you can add more power modules, you can add more cabinets, and so on. And there's never such a thing as a slow charger or a broken charger, because any faulty power modules just aren't assigned. And incidentally, power modules, these ones have temperature sensors on them, so they'll detect if there's a problem about to occur, and a technician will get sent out before it actually breaks. So it's predictive rather than reactive maintenance. So how should I connect my fleet charging infrastructure? We've talked about back offices a little bit, but a bit of a dry slide, I'm aware, but there's 1.6 and 2.0. 1.6 is the more standard communications format. It's very widespread. It's commonly used today. It's got some kind of clever features, like, for example, charge point reservation, although I've yet to see that actually being implemented. It technically can do it. There are some options that OCPP 2.0 supports that 1.6 doesn't, but then you tend to find that individual charger or charge point manufacturers will emulate those on 1.6 via an API. So they'll have their own software that mimics some of that functionality. It will only work within their own make and model of hardware, but it gives you basically 1.6 plus, if you wish. And that is it's a stable, well-supported format, loads of hardware options. 2.0 is more pioneering, it's capable of doing more, but I think everyone's a bit tentative about taking that jump to it. It is there, and if you want to use it as a fleet manager, there are definitely options available. But at the moment, 1.6 is generally the one you'll see more of. So yeah, they do communicate in very different manners. And what you will typically find is that a particular back office provider will have a list of approved hardware. Even if it says, you know, this hardware supports 1.6, our back office supports 1.6, they'll probably have tried and tested different hardware and say, this is our definitely approved list. If you want this particular hardware that hasn't been approved yet, it might be worth doing a test first. I've certainly seen that before with some public charging networks that are hardware agnostic. They'll go through a process to make sure that everything is communicating on equal terms. And also demand that your hardware and back office supports at least 1.6. with roaming SIMs as well, so you're not locked to that particular provider should you decide to change later on. Are there any further ways to reduce the electricity bills of your fleet? Well, on-site renewables is becoming such a no-brainer, on-site solar or on-site wind if you can do that as well. Looking at a domestic solar panel array, so 4 kilowatts peak, you're looking at about 4.5 pence per kilowatt hour over a 20, 25-year lifespan. So the economies of scale of doing that at commercial scale, that cost is even lower. And even with only 25% utilization of solar, it's still cheaper than grid electricity today. So you could be spilling loads over into the grid without any storage, without charging some of your EVs during the day, and it still works out. And it's perfect for fleets that have vehicles parked up during the day or just are quite resource intensive in terms of their operations. And yeah, there's potential to pair that with energy storage as well. So you can get a battery of some description and then use that battery to charge the batteries in your electric vehicles. Off-peak tariffs we've already covered. So yeah, wholesale electricity prices will vary during the day. They're often cheaper overnight. So you can use an off-peak tariff to time the charging of your car or fleet in general. And that brings down those costs considerably. Dynamic tariffs take that further. They will track the wholesale price every half hour. So peak times will be very expensive, but overnight potentially is very cheap, depending on basically how much gas and how much renewables there are on the grid. So if you fancy being even more clever about it, dynamic electricity tariffs could take that a step further, and more advanced hardware and back offices will be able to track that and charge your vehicle accordingly when it's cheapest. And then there's also vehicle to grid, or should I say vehicle to depot in this case. So somewhat limited at the moment, but very much something we'll see over the coming years, is that there are some vehicles where you can power your depot with the battery in the car, sending that electricity back via a bi-directional charger. At the moment, for fleet vehicles, it's really the Nissan Leaf and the Nissan ENV200 that do that at the moment on Shademo, and that's about it. But there is a CCS version coming. Oh, you need a special vehicle-to-grid charger to do this, of course, but CCS is coming, well, the V2G on CCS is coming. So we'll start to see that over the next few years, more vehicles supporting vehicle to grid, including vehicles that you can use in your fleet. There's also talk about bi-directional onboard chargers. So you could just use a conventional AC charge point without needing any special infrastructure because the car is doing that whole bi-directionality thing. There's already vehicles that can do that vehicle to load, so you can plug a 3-pin device into them. But it's hopefully over the next few years we'll see that extended to you plug it into the charge point at your depot and it helps to power your depot, which means that you can basically avoid using electricity or as much electricity during peak times with whatever's left in your battery and then charge that battery overnight when it's cheap or using excess renewables during the day. But what if you charge your fleet vehicles at staff homes? How can you provide charging infrastructure there? So there's a couple of options. You've got smart home charge points. So with smart charge points, you have the ability as a fleet manager to look at charging sessions, look how much electricity has been drawn, and then reimburse accordingly. There are some home charge points that even have an RFID card built into them, like my Zaptec Go I've got at home. I've registered it so that my Tesco club card is used to unlock it. And that means that if you have like a fleet card, like All-Star, for example, you potentially could use that to say, yes, I was charging my fleet vehicle, not my personal use home vehicle. And that would then be credited to the fleet manager's account and they would pay for your electricity accordingly. There's also leased home charge points. Egg is very much the pioneer on this one, but no doubt we'll see more companies doing this soon. So as a fleet manager, you could potentially provide a leased home charge point to your member of staff to charge a fleet vehicle at home. And that provides a win-win scenario for the employer, because if your employee is still with you by the end of the lease, by the point that it's paid off, then the employee can then take ownership of that hardware, and should it develop a fault, then it's up to them to maintain it. But to be honest, you know, a lot of modern charge points are pretty reliable. You shouldn't have to worry about that. If the employee leaves, then you can either hand over the lease to them or reimburse, or you know, just take it off the wall because it's technically still your asset. And then there's charging on the go as well. So you've got the likes of Bonnet and Power here who have various different fleet charging solutions. If you don't have a driveway, or if your vehicle's routinely charged on public charging, then they can offer either a fleet charging card, a bit like a fuel card, or a fleet charging app. So you can use loads of different networks. And that means that the fleet manager picks up the tab for company vehicle use. Incidentally, I've just learned that Allstar, who are roughly over there somewhere, have a similar solution as well. So there's quite a good bit of variety in the market today for fleet charging on the go or charging without a driveway solutions. So as I say, it's basically a fuel card, and company credit cards will work on charge points that accept contactless credit card payment should they not be on those networks in a worst case scenario. So you could just use a company credit card in many situations. Now Stop Press, Power has teamed up with CoCharger. CoCharger is quite a clever initiative where people who are lucky enough to have a driveway and a charge point list it on the CoCharger app. And that means that people who need to charge and don't have a driveway can search the CoCharger network for their friendly local charge point, and then you can book that and they can charge on it. So your fleet manager will give your member of staff who doesn't have a driveway a Power fuel card, at which point they will then search for a CoCharger charge point near them, and it will be credited to the Power account, in other words, the fleet manager's account. So even if your employees don't have driveways, they can still charge potentially close to home, and use the fleet manager can easily pick up the tab. And the final note to leave you on is that ChargePlay Scotland, which is a hardware agnostic network, has very much taught us the good, the bad, and the ugly when it comes to reliability of various different back offices and hardware as well. So it's worth having a look at their stories. Again, well, a lot of this is a repeat of the first slide. Good charging infrastructure is all about good reliability, compatibility with all EV makes and models, no so-called handshake issues where you know the charge point's speaking English and the back office is speaking French effectively and it's just not working. Excellent customer support, you know, really quick lead times to fix any problems, making sure that warranties are in place as well and that those are honored by both the owner and the manufacturer or supplier of that hardware. Fast time, lead times on repairs, as I said, technicians and parts in the local vicinity for very quick repairs. Learn from other local authorities, learn from other fleet managers as well. There's some very, very talented, very experienced fleet managers out there who've been through the instant success stories and the horror stories that they then had to rectify. So learn from local authorities who've made mistakes, and then you know other authorities have made really good decisions and see how that's worked out for them. A really good example is East Lothian Council, because they went from being one of the worst places in Scotland to own an EV because the charging network was utterly unreliable there. They're part of ChargePlay Scotland. Ryan Robertson, who's an absolute legend and worthy of a shout out here, he came in and turned it round in under 12 months. So it's now one of the best places, not just in Scotland, but in the UK, to own or operate an EV. There's quite a few electric fleets in East Lothian as well, and it's no wonder because the hardware just works. The network just works so smoothly. And again, never, ever, ever weight price above quality because you'll end up paying twice and paying more. Ask East Lothian Council. And finally, add installation target dates and uptime criteria to any tenders that you do and make sure that there is a get-out clause should those not be met. And that means that you have that safety net of being able to say, I've had enough, I want to get something that actually works, because you as a fleet manager have vehicles that have a job to do and you want to make sure that they can do that with no problems. Thank you very much for your time. Incidentally, as I mentioned before, I do have my humble little YouTube channel, which does quite a lot of myth busting and so on. It's on YouTube. If there's any more queries that you have, we've barely scratched the surface today. So you'll find me on there and you'll also find me at the email address there. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Euan. I'm just going to drill into something a bit further, actually, because you touched on standards. Lizzie, you also touched on standards within your presentation, and you both commented on reliability. So what is happening and what should be happening, I guess, is where I'm talking about. When you, as a driver, you rock up in your brand new vehicle, and the charger doesn't talk to it. Because that is actually happening more and more often now, especially with the more modern vehicles that we're getting.
Yeah.
So I'm going to touch all three of you, actually, because I think, Alex, you actually put in charge points and can talk about it. You and you touched on those standards. And I think probably about what we should do may come back to you, Lizzie. So you in first.
Sure. So I think probably the biggest issue we found is on CCS, so the rapid charging standard that's won the format war. Whereas if you look at CHAdeMO, that was incredibly tightly defined. This is how you will do everything. And that's why it worked first time, every time. CCS, I describe it as being, they gave you the ingredients to make a cake, but not the recipe. And a lot of people made French toast instead. And it just doesn't communicate properly as a result. So there's been a lot of, particularly on older rapid chargers, there's been a lot of situations where manufacturers and suppliers have had to go back out into the wilderness, literally like in the middle of nowhere, to get these remote charge points and update the firmware on them because some EV manufacturer or car manufacturer who's new to EVs bungled their attempt at CCS. And of course, the charger gets the blame. But sometimes it is rightly the charger's fault. There are some chargers that it doesn't matter what you throw at them, they just work. And there's some that are a bit more fussy about their interpretation of the protocol. But that is something that, you know, as globally the EV community needs to try and resolve this standard issue with CCS, but we're gradually getting there.
So it's the charger's fault, Alex. What are you doing about it?
Thank you, Lorna. First of all, just want to say thank you very much to you and to Lizzie for the presentations there. I thought really fantastic overview, and to get that much into the few minutes that we had was very, very impressive, so thank you. We have suffered pain not just on the public facing units, but also in the units that serve our fleet customers where we've had issue with regulation. And I think it almost is as simple as, the issue we have is that the OEMs don't have to design to the same regulation as the charge point manufacturers. And when you've got that, you're always going to have an issue. So we work hard to be able to tweak our software where we have irregularities in OEM software to make sure that we can keep people moving. But we need to align. I think it's as simple as that.
I'm going to come back to you, Lizzie, because we talked about standards, and we know there's PAS 1899 that's coming out. So is there anything then that we could or should be doing or are already doing that we're not aware of to try and help with some of these? I'm conscious of putting you on the spot with that one.
That's all right. I think there's two answers to the question. One, on the vehicle side, my colleagues in our international vehicle standards team do a lot of work internationally to try and bring in standards on the vehicle side that make sure that there is that consistency. And then on the charge point side, I mentioned earlier, and I think there's two things here. One, on open data, so people, when they go to the charge point, know what kind of charge point it is, whether it's working, and whether they can fit in the space next to the charge point. And then the second, on the reliability mandate, that all the rapid charges will be 99% reliable mandated. And also have a 24-hour helpline, so if you do have any problems, you can instantly get hold of somebody, because I know that is sometimes a problem with charge points where you're trying to ring a number and you're not getting anywhere and you're stuck trying to charge your vehicle. So that's the reason for that second bit as well.
So thank you. I'm just trying to get an indication of how much time we've got, because I know we started later. 5 minutes? Thank you. Right, in which case, one quick more question through, and then I'll throw it out. So, Lizzie, you talked about the 1.6 billion that's covering. So there's 950 on the Rapid Charge Fund. The rest is on the Levi Fund. A lot of the people in the audience will have cars, vans, and heavy goods trucks. How much of that is going to help the heavy goods industry as well, or is there more still to be done in that area?
So the 950 Rapid Charging Fund with motorway service stations and A roads, that fund is currently in development about where that funding will be going. It's focused on the electricity capacity at those areas so they can future-proof and put those charges in. And we're working really closely to make sure that kind of all vehicles that need to use them are included. And then on the Levi Fund, which is that 500 million, really keen that government sets the framework, but actually local charging solutions are decided locally because they best know kind of what fleets they have in the area, what kind of charging is best, whether kind of what type of charging, where it's put, where it needs to be kind of different size parking bays or whether it's mainly residential. So that's why part of the fund is capital, but then part of it is actually resource for those local authorities to have the people and capability to make those right decisions. And then there's a little bit extra because you realise it doesn't quite add up, which is all the workplace grants and business grants that are still available.
Thank you very much. Alex, you may have the only roving mic. So is there anyone out there with a burning question? We have one down here on the right. You can give us your name and just...
Yeah, hi. My name is Martin Beaumont. From my business is Electric Green, and we're developing wireless EV charging. But my question to the panel is, can you give a bit of insight into the sort of arm wrestle between AC versus DC charging and what factors are driving that? And how much of it's got to do with OEM vehicle makers pushing cost of rectification from the vehicle onto the charge point providers?
Any takers?
I can have.
I think everyone's looking at you,
Euan. Yeah, fair enough. Yeah, happy enough to. I very much doubt we will see a stage where an electric passenger car will not have AC on it, because the ability to easily charge at home on your own rooftop solar or off-peak electricity is just so vast. And you're probably talking, I mean, obviously in the UK, we're typically single-phase to houses anyway. In continental Europe, we're seeing quite a lot of demand from German customers who've got three-phase for 22 kilowatts. So now we're seeing 22 kilowatt becoming optional from some of the OEMs like Audi, for example. So that cost may somewhat get pushed onto the consumer as an optional upgrade from the standard 7 or 11 kilowatt onboard charger. But yeah, that AC will still be there. And then obviously DC will do the heavy lifting when on your sort of motorway journeys, and we'll see more demand for increasingly higher charging power. Although we may find that that kind of plateaus to a degree as the efficiency of electric vehicles improves. We're seeing a lot of, look at the Mercedes EQXX concept, for example, and how that will gradually trickle into mainstream vehicles. And then the Uptera, which kind of looks like, I can only describe it as looking like a ground plane. You know, it's a phenomenal thing that does about 10 miles per kilowatt hour. We will see more mainstreamish versions of those with high efficiency coming forwards, which means that your charging time at, say, 200 kilowatts will be even faster to give you more range than it would be on, say, an Ioniq 5 today, where you're doing about 3 miles per kilowatt hour on the motorway. So, yeah, DC will probably plateau for cars at somewhere between 200 and 300 kilowatts, but for heavy-duty vehicles, that will continue to climb upwards because of the relevant size of the battery involved. But AC is always going to be there, because there would be riots if you took that away. But I appreciate, yeah, the onboard charger is an additional cost, and if you could just shove that onto someone else, in other words, you know, the charging networks, then that makes your vehicle cheaper, but consumers will demand AC, guaranteed.
Okay. Anyone else with a burning question? Let's talk, Hill.
Can you hear me?
Yep, can hear you now.
Hi, Charlie. I'm sorry, I've got two questions. Number one, how fast can I charge from a lamppost charger? And how far away are we from universal adoption of plug and charge?
Okay. Yeah. Well, for lamppost charging, that very much does depend on the power supply that's available. Quite often, lamppost charging uses redundant extra capacity that would have been used for sodium discharge lamps that have now been replaced with LED. So yeah, you're typically between, it's like 3 and 5 kilowatts, if I recall correctly, which, yeah, for bigger battery EVs becomes an issue. If you've got a 30 kilowatt hour Nissan Leaf from 2016, you get an overnight charge, no bother. If you've got a 100 kilowatt hour Tesla Model S, then yeah, you're going to have a couple of nights at it.
Or a van, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, or a van, absolutely. So it's very much a horses for courses thing. But then again, so few people turn up at a charge point with nothing left in the battery and then genuinely need a full charge. You'll probably charge it, say, 50-ish percent of its capacity, in which case that overnight charging is useful. It's better than nothing. But that said, a dedicated, discrete on-street charging solution. Again, I'm thinking Connected Kerb. I'm thinking Trojan Energy, which is a very neat solution. Very discrete solution that's flush with the Kerb, doesn't take up space, etc. Those come in useful because they can potentially do 22 kilowatts. And then if it's dynamic load managed, then you may find your kilowattage coming back down. But if you're the only person there and you're the first on, yeah, I'm going to get full charge power off that. So yeah, lamppost charging, not ideal, but could be a lot worse. And actually, when you look at how it's going to get used, then yeah, an overnight charge probably gives you what you were looking for in many cases anyway. But for high utilization vans, you need something a little bit more substantial.
And I think your second question was plug and charge.
Plug and charge, yeah. There's a lot of money going around for infrastructure. I mean, can we mandate that they have the latest protocols to make it easier for drivers and charge point operators? Because there seems to be, as I think Euan said, a different language, so you can't just flick a switch. It's quite the challenge to convert legacy charge points, especially to...
True, true. If I recall correctly, OCPP 2.0 supports plug and charge natively. That said, older chargers don't necessarily support 2.0, and that's where that problem lies. It will be a while yet before everybody gets the Tesla experience of, you know, just plug in and the billing is taken care of automatically, it just starts charging. But yeah, with 2.0, we're starting to see, I believe Fastned was one of the first non-Tesla movers with plug and charge. Mercedes is experimenting with it. So it is coming. It's probably going to be somewhat piecemeal, and we do need a more sort of collaborative approach on that.
But so we have a CPO on the stage, so he's nodding. So Alex.
Yeah, yeah.
Need a mic. We need the mic back. All right, stand. Lexhorn. Alex.
Oh, yeah.
That's all right.
Second. Is that working okay?
Yay.
Yes, sorry, everybody. So on plug and charge, that is something that we currently have in play, although it's in the EU. So that's working in Germany at present, and it's something we would love to get over here really as soon as it's humanly possible, because it's a great user experience.
So Lizzie, on that, is there anything that we're going to do from a government point of view to help mandate?
So it's quite early on in our charging network journey, so government wouldn't at the moment seeking to mandate something like that to make sure that kind of that all the options are open and all the technologies that are emerging at the moment have that chance to come forward. So it's quite early to make that big step to make that mandate at the moment. But as I said before, we're kind of keeping everything under review, and we'll see if further regulation is needed.
Go on, Simon, I'll let you have one quick go before I get told off for overrunning.
Hi there, Simon King, Eaton 7, I was Director of Sustainability.
Just keep your mic up.
Okay, if I just keep it up there, then great, wonderful. Quick one on roaming. Sorry, I appreciate there's a BP Pulse representative on the stage, but clearly what all fleets want is just to be able to rock up to a charger and use it, not to have to worry about, is it on a network, you know, have I got a power card? Have I got an all-star card? Whatever. So, sorry, this is probably for you, Lizzie, but where are we at from a roaming point of view and actually pushing the industry to make that happen?
So part of the regulations that are coming forward that were announced alongside that EV infrastructure strategy is looking at minimum payment solutions and making sure that the payments on those charge points are really simple, easy to use, and really transparent, so people know when they turn up how much it's going to cost to charge and how they can pay for it, and things like making sure contactless payment is available, etc. But that is coming forward in regulation to try and solve that problem, to make it easier for people to just use which charge points they come across.
Thank you. We're unfortunately out of time, because I think there's all sorts of things we could learn from these wonderful people on the stage. So can you please give a round of applause to Lizzie, Euan, and Alex.